I feel that some of you might be thinking, but I'm not righteous. Who am I? I'm not righteous. But God is saying today that you are righteous. God, when you accept Jesus, He is the one who has made you righteous. It is not you walking in your own strength who has made yourself righteous. It is Jesus who has made you righteous.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts.
God is good
all the time.
Okay. Well, I'm going to be preaching today. Before I preach, I'll say a short prayer, then I'll go into the Word. Dear Lord, I just want to thank you for this opportunity that you've given me to speak to your people, Lord God. I pray, Lord, that you will place your words on my mouth, Lord God, that you will speak through me, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that you will bring your people a word, Lord God, that will meet them at their point of need, Lord God, that will inspire and encourage them, Lord God. I am your vessel, Lord, and I just pray that you will just use me today, Lord God. Open this congregation's ears, Lord God, and their hearts so they will receive the words that you are going to give them today. Amen. Amen. We serve a good God, don't we?
Yes.
Yes. Our God is faithful. He's the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Who else do we have except our Lord? When we call on him, he answers. And he is just so faithful and so awesome. But even though he exists, the devil also exists. The devil is real. And the devil would want you to feel that he doesn't exist, that he's not around. But the Bible says that we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. In 1 Peter 5, verse 8, Christians are called to be sober, to be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. So I think it's important that we have a true understanding of, number one, who God is. We know our God is faithful. We know he's powerful. We know that we can do anything with Christ on our side. But we also need to know and understand who the devil is so that we can prepare ourselves against him so we will not fall under the attacks that he may try to put in our lives. So today, I'm going to talk about spiritual weapons that we can use to defend ourselves against the enemy. As you look in this world, if you just listen to the news, you hear stories of war, stories of crime, people killing one another. You can see that the devil is running rampant in this world. And it's time that we take action and take back this ground for the Lord. This is God's world. We are God's people. And if we humble ourselves and pray for our nation, God will move in this country. But I even feel in our own Christian journeys as well, the devil is sometimes even attacking us in little things that we do as well. Jesus died for us so we could experience the fullness of life. He died for us so that we could have everlasting joy, everlasting peace. And the devil is robbing us of this. I do not feel that as Christians, people should be suffering from the depression and sadness and be addicted to certain things. But this is true. There are Christians, there are people here who are suffering from those type of things. And I feel that God's saying that this is the end. He's got a gift for you. He's got joy for you. He's got peace for you. And he wants you to grab onto those things. So we're going to start by reading 2 Chronicles 20, verse 1 to 24. Akin's going to come and read for us.
That's page 452 if you've got the church Bible. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verses 1 to 24. After this, the Moabites and the Ammonites, with some of the Mennonites, came to make war on Jehoshaphat. Some men came and told Jehoshaphat, "A vast army is coming against you from Edom, from the other side of the sea. It is already in Hazazon Tamar, that is En-Gedi. Alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord, and he proclaimed a fast for all Judah. The people of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town in Judah to seek him. Then Jehoshaphat stood up in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem at the temple of the Lord in the front of the new courtyard and said, O Lord, God of our fathers, are you not the God who is in heaven? You rule over all the kingdoms of the nation. Power and might are in your hand, and no one can withstand you. O our God, did you not drive out the inhabitants of this land before your people, Israel, and give it forever the descendants of Abraham, your friend? They have lived in it and have built in it a sanctuary for your name, saying, if calamity comes upon us, whether the sword of judgment or plague, or famine, we will stand in your presence before this temple that bears your name, and will cry out to you in our distress, and you will hear us and save us. But now, here are men from Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, whose territory you would not allow Israel to invade when they came from Egypt. So they turned away from them and did not destroy them. See how they are repaying us by coming to drive us out of the possession you gave us as an inheritance. O our Lord, O our God, will you not judge them? For we have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are upon you. All the men of Judah, with their wives and children and little ones, stood there before the Lord. Then the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jazel, son of Zechariah, the son of Benaniah, the son of Jael, the son of Mattaniah, a Levite and a descendant of Asaph, as he stood in the assembly. He said, listen, King Jehoshaphat, and all who live in Judah and Jerusalem, this is what the Lord says to you. Do not be afraid or discouraged because of this vast army, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Tomorrow, march down against them. They will be climbing up by the pass of Zir, and you will find them at the end of the gorge in the desert of Jeruel. You will not have to fight this battle. Take up your positions, stand firm, and see the deliverance the Lord will give you, O Judah and Jerusalem. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Go out to face them tomorrow, and the Lord will be with you. Jehoshaphat bowed with his face to the ground, and all the people of Judah and Jerusalem fell down in worship before the Lord. Then some Levites from Kohathites and Korahites stood up and praised the Lord, the God of Israel, with a very loud voice. Early in the morning, they left for the desert of Tekoa. As they set out, Jehoshaphat stood and said, listen to me, Judah and people of Jerusalem. Have faith in the Lord your God, and you will be upheld. Have faith in his prophets, and you will be successful. After consulting the people, Jehoshaphat appointed men to sing to the Lord and praise, to sing to the Lord and to praise him for the splendor of his holiness, as they went out at the head of the army, saying, Give thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever. As they began to sing and praise, the Lord set ambushes against the men of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir, who were invading Judah, and they were defeated. the men of Ammon and Moab rose up against the men from Mount Seir to destroy and annihilate them. After they finished slaughtering the men from Seir, they helped to destroy one another. When the men of Judah came to the place that overlooks the desert and looked towards the vast army, they saw only dead bodies lying on the ground. No one had escaped.
This is the word of the Lord. I feel that we can learn a lot from this passage. As Christians, we go through the difficult times. We go through challenging times. We go through times when we feel that we are being attacked by the enemy. And when you think about the situation with Jehoshaphat, he was being attacked by three different armies. All of them are coming to try to defeat his nation. And you can imagine how afraid and how terrified he must have felt. But in his terror, he went to the Lord for guidance. And the first thing I want to ask all of you, when you know that you're being attacked, when you're afraid, who do you first go to? Do you go to the Lord, or do you try to sort things out yourself? Do you try to solve the problem yourself, or try to consult others before coming to the Lord? He must have been so frightened. Three different nations coming to try to take over his nation. And as Christians, at times, we feel like we're being attacked from every corner, from every single side. At the same time, we lose our job. That's when we feel like we have no money. At the same time, we're not well. And this is how the devil works. They say when it rains, it pours. And I feel like with King Jehoshaphat, he also may have been feeling like that. But what he did, the first thing that he did that I think was good is that he went to the Lord, and he went to the Lord for guidance. And in the same way, as Christians, when we are going through battles, when we're being attacked by the enemy, we should go first to the Lord and ask him for guidance and ask him what to do and plead for his help. So you might be asking, where can we get God's guidance? And this is where I come to talk about the first spiritual weapon, and that is the word. When you read in Ephesians 6 about putting on the armor of God, there's a lot of the offensive armor that God tells you to put on, like the helmet of salvation, the belt of truth. But as I've said, But the only weapon that you can attack with is the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And I just want to say that the word is a place where we can get so much guidance from God. In Psalm 119, verse 105, it says, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." The Bible, God's words, where we can get direction. When we're facing troubles, when we don't know where to turn, when we feel like the world is collapsing on us, it is the word that we should go to first. To ask God, "God, please lead me, direct me, speak to me through your word." And God will surely speak to you. He will give you a word to meet you at your point of need. But you need to go asking the Holy Spirit to speak to you. And instead of going to others or just trying to solve the problem in flesh, go to the word. Ask God to speak to you. Ask God to guide you. Because that's where he will speak to you. That's where you will truly, truly hear from him. And I want to quickly go to Matthew 7, verse 24 to 27. "Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who puts his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash." Before our trials come, before we start going through our hard times, it's important that we lay our foundations on the word of God. Every morning we should go, or even we should go into God's word and ask him to guide us, for him to speak to us. Because when we're going through our trials, when we're being tempted, it's the word of God that will get us through. As I've said, when the devil's trying to tell you that there's nowhere out, when you feel overwhelmed, you can recite scripture. In the Bible, there's so many promises that God has poured over his people. And if you don't read the Bible, how do you expect to know the promises? That is why you need to prepare yourself against the wiles of the enemy, because he wants to attack you, but you need to defend yourself. You need to prepare yourself. So before you actually even get attacked, you need to know his word. You need to sow into it. Every day you need to be looking into it, asking God to speak to you, because then you're building your life on the right foundation. So when the storms come, when difficult times come, you'll be able to get through. God will help you get through. But if you're not aware of the promises, if you don't know who God is, how do you expect to be able to use these tools when the difficulty comes? So I feel the first thing that God is trying to say today is that the word is a weapon. It's a weapon that God has given you because he loves you and he wants you to get through the challenges of life. Yeah. Another thing that you can look at with King Jehoshaphat, he called on an annual fast. And when he was being attacked and he knew that he was in great danger, he was alarmed, but he went to the Lord for guidance and he asked his nation to embark on a fast. And I want to say today that fasting is another weapon that you can use to hear from God, for him to intervene in your situation. If you look in the Bible, there's so many characters who fasted. If you look at Moses, he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights on Mount Sinai, and that's when he received when God gave him the Ten Commandments. If you look at Esther, when the Jews were going to be killed and massacred, she also went on a three-day fast, and she asked her people to fast as well. If you look in the New Testament, our Savior Jesus, he also fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. So how much more should we, when we feel like we're being attacked, fast and plead for God to intervene in our situation and plead to God to help us? And also in a time of fasting, it's a time where we step away, because foods can sometimes distract us, but we go away from the distraction and we focus on God. We set our eyes no longer on the problem, but we set our eyes on God, and we ask him to intervene for us. So this is another weapon that our Heavenly Father has given us. And as we see with the life of Jesus, when he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, I just want to go and quickly say something about the word of God again. If you look at when Jesus was tempted, Satan quoted scripture at him, but it's only because Jesus knew that he was trying to twist things, that he was able to come back with scripture. And this is also, I think, is showing the importance of knowing God's word, because the devil will try to twist things, to try to twist things in the Bible. And if you don't know your Bible, you will just fall under his trick and his plan. But that's why you need to know the word for yourself. So when you do go through temptation, when you do go through hard things, you'll be able to stand on God's word. You will know God's word. It is placed on your heart and in your mind, and you will be able to get through. Another spiritual weapon is prayer. I think we can learn so much from the prayer that King Jehoshaphat prays in 2 Chronicles. So if we go back to that scripture. O Lord God of our fathers, are you not the God who is in heaven? You rule over the kingdoms of the nations. Power and might are in your hand, and no one can withstand you. O our God, did you not drive out the inhabitants of this land before Israel and give it forever to the descendants of Abraham, your friend? They have lived in it and have built in it a sanctuary for your name, saying, if calamity comes upon us, whether the sword of judgment or plague or famine, we will stand in your presence before this temple that bears your name and will cry out to you in our distress, and you will hear us and save us. But now here are men from Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, whose territory you would not allow Israel to invade when they came from Egypt. So they turned away from them and did not destroy them. See how they are repaying us by coming to drive us out of the possession you gave us as an inheritance. O our God, will you not judge them? For we have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are upon you. I feel that as Christians, we can learn so much from this prayer. If we look at what King Jehoshaphat did and his prayer that he prayed, at first, when he saw that he was being attacked, when he saw the problem, He prayed and he looked up to God. He recorded God's power, how awesome he is, how he is able to sort out this problem for them. And in the same way, I feel as Christians, when we are facing difficulties, when we are facing hardships, we need to look to God. We need to remind ourselves of how faithful, how awesome our God is. The God who created the heavens, the God who created the universe, the God who created you and me. He is the God who you are serving. He is a mighty God. Therefore, he can get you through any single situation. When you lift your eyes on God and lift your eyes away from the situation, he will come through for you. And I think this is why King Jehoshaphat first started with acknowledging who God is and how powerful he is. He then looked back into the past and thought about all the things God had done for him and his nation, all the things God had did and all the things God had saved them from. And in the same way, all of us have testimonies. The fact that we're alive, the fact that we are well, we all have a story of how God has come through for us. If we just look into the past, or even look into the last week, we will all be able to recall something that our Heavenly Father has done for us. So in the same way, when you're going through difficulties, when you're going through trials, start to recount all the things that God has done for you. The God who got you through school, the God who got you through university, the God who got you your job, the God who's got you your faith. He is faithful and he remains faithful. He's the same today. He's the same. He was the same in the past. He's the same today and he will be the same in the present. Therefore, if he was faithful then, he will be faithful now. And I feel God just wants you to remind yourself, when you're going through difficult times, remind yourself of that. And if you're finding it hard to think about the things that God has done for you in the past, go into God's word. God has done so many things for his people, and you also are son and daughter of God. If you think about Moses and the Israelites, he delivered them from slavery. The Red Sea parted for them so they could cross over and go into freedom. If you think about even Jesus, that he rose from the dead. Jesus was able to conquer death and he rose from the dead so that our sins will be cancelled. So even if you can't think about things in your life that you can give God glory for, just think about the amazing things that he has done in this world. And the same God that Moses served, the same God that Paul served, is the same God that you serve. So no matter what you're going through, no matter what problem you are facing, God is able to get you through. But you only just have to trust him. You only have to trust him. Another thing I think with King Jehoshaphat, after that, he started to just point out the situation to God. He said, God, this is the issue. This is what's happening. We're being attacked. These people who we spared now have come back to attack us. God wants us to be honest with him. God wants us to speak. He wants us to pour out our heart's desires from him. If you know you're facing addiction, if you know you're facing pain, God wants you to just lay down your worries and cast your burdens onto him. He loves you and he cares and he is willing to listen. The fourth thing that King Jehoshaphat did was that he acknowledged that without God, he is not able to fight this war. He said, we do not know what to do, but our eyes are upon you. As Christians, when we are going through difficult times, we have to acknowledge that we cannot do it by ourselves. We cannot do it in our own power. We cannot do it in our own strength, but we can do it by God's grace. We need to tap into God's strength. We need to tap into God's power. If you think you can do it by yourself, you will fail. But once you acknowledge that it is God who is fighting for you, once you acknowledge that it is God on your side, he will come through for you. But you need to acknowledge that it's him who you are getting your strength from. It's okay to say, like, God, I don't know how to deal with this problem. I don't know how I'm going to pay these bills, but Lord, but I know that you know, Lord. I know that you are faithful. I know that you will find a way. You will make a way where there is no way. But you just have to acknowledge that your God is able. Acknowledge that you are not able, but your God is able. I thank God that without him, I can do nothing, but I thank God that with him, I can do all things. When Christ is with you, who can be against you? And these are the type of things that you need to be reminding yourself when you are being attacked by the enemy. The enemy doesn't want you to win. The enemy doesn't want you to succeed. But we thank God that God wants us to succeed. We thank God that we have a future in Christ Jesus. We thank God that he has set a path for us. But we just have to believe that he has done it. We have to have faith in him. And when you read this prayer, King Jehoshaphat had faith. He had faith that God was able to come through for him. He knew that God would come through to him. And when you are praying, when you are in the midst of your troubles, you need to pray in faith, knowing that your God is faithful, knowing that your God is able. Even if we have faith just as small as a mustard seed, God will come through for us, but we need to have that faith to get us through. Just want to again emphasize how important prayer is. There's nothing, as I said, there's nothing too big or too small to do for God to do. God wants to come through for you, and the devil will make you think that your problem is too big for God to solve. The devil will make you think that the mountain is too big. But God is saying today, take your eyes off the mountain and look at me. Take your eyes off the mountain and look at me. I am able to resolve this problem for you. I am able to give you peace. I am able to give you joy. I am able to take you out of this prison of depression. God is able, if you just allow him to come through for you. In Ephesians 6, verse 18, we're told to pray in the Spirit at all times and on every occasion. Stay alert and be persistent in your prayers for all believers everywhere. So this is what I mean. Even before the trials come, even before the hard times, we need to be persistent in our prayers. We need to be persistent, asking God to cover us with the blood of Jesus, asking God to go ahead and prepare a way for us. We have to be persistent in reading the word. We have to be persistent in praising him. It's not until the day of trouble comes or the day of trials come that you should start reading your Bible or praying. You need to start doing it before. You need to start preparing yourself. Because God wants you to get through, and he will help you get through. But you just have to tap into his strength, tap into his power, and not rely on yourself. James 5, verse 16 to 18 also says, "The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth produced its fruit." The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. I feel that some of you might be thinking, but I'm not righteous. Who am I? I'm not righteous. But God is saying today that you are righteous. God, when you accept Jesus, he is the one who has made you righteous. It is not you walking in your own strength who has made yourself righteous. It is Jesus who has made you righteous. And when you continue to try to live a life that glorifies God, and if you continue to pursue righteousness, God will be with you. So I feel like God is saying to you today that your prayer is effective. Your prayer will avail much. God will answer your prayers, but you have to believe that he will answer your prayers. You have to believe that he's going to get you through this trial. You have to believe that this that you will be victorious, that this battle that you are facing, you will be victorious over. So a way that the enemy tries to work to act is that he will make you feel like your prayer doesn't work, your prayer that God is not listening. But God is saying today that he is listening to your prayer. Be persistent. Keep on knocking on the door. He said, "Knock and the door will be open to you." He said, "Ask and you will receive." God is ready to answer your prayers, but you have to say them in faith. You have to believe that he will come through for you. And you have to remember that not your timing, God's timing. God is wise. He knows all, and he will deliver you in his timing. And we just have to ask for his patience and ask that God will just help you stand through and get through your trial, because he will get you through. But you just have to keep on holding on. There's so many people who've suffered and have experienced so much pain, and they just give up halfway through, not knowing that their testimony was only a week later or their testimony was coming. We need to hold on to our testimony, to the faith that God is able, that he will bring you through what you're going through. You need to hold on to the promises that God has for you. When you're going through your test, know that by God's grace, there will be a testimony after this test, that you will sing of how glorious God has been, and you will give all glory to God, because you will know that he is the one who has got you through this situation. That it wasn't by your might, it wasn't by your power, but it was by God's Spirit. So I just want to say that we should just be, just continue praying. Stop, don't give up. Don't think that all is lost. Don't let the devil lie to you that your prayers will not be answered, that God is not listening. God is listening. God loves you. God wants to help you. And just tap into God's power. Just pray to him, read his word, and just tap into his power. A fourth weapon, I think it's fifth now, but another weapon that God has given us is the weapon of praise. If you look at verse 20, we'll start from verse 20. chapter of 2 Chronicles. It says, early in the morning, they left for the desert of Tekoa. As they set out, Jehoshaphat stood and said, listen to me, Judah and people of Jerusalem. Have faith in the Lord your God, and you will be upheld. Have faith in his prophets, and you will be successful. After consulting the people, Jehoshaphat appointed men to sing to the Lord and to praise him for the splendor of his holiness as they went out at the head of the army, saying, give thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever. As they began to sing and praise, the Lord set ambushes against the men of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir, who were invading Judah, and they were defeated. So before King Jehoshaphat went to war, he put out a praise and worship troop to go out in front of him, to just praise God, to just glorify God, to just lift up his name. And can you believe it? They did not even have to fight the battle. The enemy started fighting one another. And I feel that God is saying today that the battle is his, that if you just acknowledge him, if you praise and worship him, this battle, you will not even have to fight it by yourself. God will go ahead and fight the battle for you, that you will not even have to do anything other than just acknowledge him and just praise him. And I feel some that what God wants to talk to us today about worship and praise, that there is power in praise and worship. There is power. When you come and on Sunday mornings, or when you're praising God in your house, there is power in your praise and worship. It brings God into the situation. We know that God inhabits in the praises of his people. So as you're praising God, as you're worshiping God, you are bringing God into your situation. God is coming down into the situation. And another thing about praise, praise glorifies God. It gives him honor and glory. But I think praise, God has created praise even for us, to do something for us. When you're going through your trial, when you're going through your hardship, and you're singing, my God is faithful, you're reminding yourself of the faithfulness of God. When you're going through your heartache, and you're knowing, and you're singing songs about how steadfast he is, how he created the world, you're reminding yourself that God, the creator of the world, is on your side. So when you praise God, it lifts up your spirit. It gives you power. It gives you strength to know that I can get through this. With God on my side, I can get through this. And this is why I think when you're going through a difficult time, when you wake up depressed and you're sad, start singing praises to God. Start acknowledging him. Start lifting up his name. Start giving him glory, because he will lift up your spirit. He will rise you up, and he will go ahead of you and start fighting that battle for you. He loves you so much. Acknowledge him in your praises, because he is awesome. He is great. There is none like him. And when you praise him, you are reminding yourself of who God is. Another example where you see where praise and worship release someone from the enemy, if you think at Paul and Silas, when they were put into jail, as they started to praise and worship God, their shackles fell off, the prison doors were open. And I thought that God is also saying today that there's people who are imprisoned by fear, there's people imprisoned by depression, there's people imprisoned by addiction. And God wants to say today that he will free you from this oppression. He will fill you from this imprisonment. He wants to take you out of it. But you have to believe that he will. When you're going through your trial, just praise God and he will release you. He will give you freedom. He will take you out of it. But just have the faith that your God is able. We may not be able, but God is able. He is more than able to come through for you. And sometimes when I think about it, I think, as Christians, there's certain things that are not our portion. Sadness should not be our portion. Depression should not be our portion. Addiction to drugs or cigarettes or to anything that we're addicted to is not our portion. Jesus came to give us freedom, and we need to tap into that. Sometimes I wonder that there should be a difference between us and those who are in the world. But sometimes you look at Christians, you look at non-Christians, and we're dealing with the same issues. But I feel that God is saying that he wants to free you from those issues. He wants to take you out of it. The difference between us and non-Christians is that we have accepted Christ. We know that it is he who has the power. It's not us who have the power, but it's he who has the power. So God's saying today, come to me, all who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He wants to give you rest. He wants to give you freedom. He wants to take you out of this problem that you're going through, this battle that you're facing with the enemy, this battle that you've been going through for the past 2 years, 3 years. God wants to give you freedom for it. He wants to liberate you from the pain that you are going through. And before I close, there's another really powerful section in this passage. When God says to the army, "Do not be afraid, do not be discouraged by this mighty army, for the battle is not yours, but God's." God is saying to you today, this battle that you're going through, this hardship that you are going through, it is not yours, it is God's. God will come and fight for you. God will come and come through for you. But you just have to tap into his power. Do these things, because the thing about prayer, the thing about worship, the thing about reading the Bible is that you're tapping into God's strength. You're acknowledging that, God, I can't do this by myself. I leave it to you. So God is saying today that I will come for you. When you rely on me, when you depend on me, I will come and fight this battle for you. You do not have to worry. You don't need to fear. I will come before you and fight the enemy for you. I will take away your sadness. I will take away your pain. I will take away your hardships. God wants to help you today. And I just want you to tap into God's power today to say no to the enemy, that for no longer am I going to be bound by this spirit of sadness. But no longer am I going to be jobless. No longer am I going to want to take away my life. There's things that Christians go through that God doesn't want us to go through, but if only we just relied on God, if only we just acknowledged who our Father is, because he is more than able, he is more than able to get you through this situation. Just encourage yourself, remind yourself that greater is he that lives in you than he that is in this world. Think about the strength that you have through Jesus Christ. The same power that rose Jesus Christ from the dead is available to you. It's available to you to get over your situations. It's available to you to be victorious over the battle. But you just have to believe it. You have to tap into it. And today, before we're going to have a time of worship after this. And I know that there's people here today who are hurting. You've come to church, but you're hurting. You know that you've got problems that you're trying to deal with, but I feel that God is saying today, come to me and I will give you rest. This battle that you're fighting is not yours. It is mine, and I will fight for you. So while you're listening to the song that's going to be played, just let God speak to you. Just let God remind you that the battle is not his, that the battle is not yours. It is his. And then we're going to just go into a time of worship where you'll be able to receive prayer, but we've just put these words that we've heard into action. Let's just worship God. Let's acknowledge God. And let's take our eyes away from the mountain and move them onto God. Because God is greater than the mountain. The mountain might be great. The problem that you're facing might seem great, but our God is greater. Our God is greater and he is able. So as you listen to this song, just let God speak to you. And then we'll go into a time of worship. God hasn't brought you this far to leave you. He said, when you go through the waters and floods of life, he will be with you. When you go through the fires, you will not be burned. He will be with you. God is with you, going through the trial that you are going through. But you have to just believe that he will be victorious over this battle. For God is speaking to some people today who felt like they want to give up. God is calling you not to give up today, that there is hope, that God has given you hope, and he will get through. To those of you who have not accepted Christ, as I said before, without Christ, I'm able to do nothing. Without Christ, none of us are able to do anything. So if you're going through certain battles or hardships, without him, you will not be victorious. But with him, you will be victorious and accept him. And to all of you that have accepted Christ, God wants to take you to a higher level. There's certain issues that he doesn't want you to deal with anymore. But just rely on him and just remember that the battle is not yours, but the battle is the Lord's. So we're going to have a time of worship. If you feel that you're going through something and you'd like to receive prayer, I welcome you to come to the front and someone will pray for you. But even if you just, while we're just worshiping today, just give God the glory and just allow him to just take control of this battle that you are facing. Let's just worship him now. We're going to just worship him for a few minutes, and let's just acknowledge him and just give him the glory that he deserves. Yes, Lord, you are our rock in times of trouble, Lord. Our hope is in you alone, and no one else but you, Lord, do we depend on. And we thank you, Lord God, that you have given us victory over the enemy, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that we are victorious with you, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, that without you we can do nothing, but with you we can do all things, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, that greater is the spirit that is in us than the spirit in this world, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that we are overcomers through Christ Jesus, Lord God. And I pray, Lord God, that today people will be set free from the works of the enemy, Lord God. People who've been imprisoned by fear, imprisoned by depression, Lord God. People who need healing, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, today that you will bring your healing to this place, Lord God, that you will heal emotional and physical wounds, Lord Jesus. You said that by your stripes we have been healed, Lord God. And I pray that today, Lord God, that people will be healed, Lord God. I thank you, Lord, for the words that you have given us, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that the words that we have heard, Lord God, will bear fruit in our lives, Lord God, that the enemy will not take these words away from us, Lord God, that as we go home this week, Lord God, your praise will be on our lips, Lord God, that we will study your word, Lord God, that you will give us an excitement and a passion for your word, Lord God, that we will pray to you, Lord God, that we will worship you, Lord God, and we will see chains falling off, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that you will give us the power, Lord God, to pray for our nation, Lord God. We pray, Lord God, that you will come down to this earth, Lord God, and we will see things changing in this world, Lord God. There'll be no more pain, no more suffering, Lord God, but your name will be glorified in this place, Lord God. We thank you, Jesus. We give you the glory. We thank you for speaking to us today, Lord God. May your words not go void, Lord God. Help us put your words into practice, Lord. We give you the glory, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv.